So I think it's a bit more than 9 o'clock, so let's start. So I will talk today about S2S model initialization and ensemble generation. So that's a topic that has already been quite discussed in previous talks, Adrian Tompkins and others. So there will be a bit of a repeat, but I think sometimes it's not bad to see several times the same concept. So I will start, first of all, with a model initialization. And so this slide here represents the end-to-end forecasting system, like the one of the S2S models, like ECMWF or NSEP and others. So first stage is observation, is to collect observation from for the atmosphere, for the ocean. I will go a bit more in details later on. The second stage is to transform those observations into initial conditions. So it's to sort of project those observations into the model space so that those initial conditions are at the same resolution than the model we will run. Then we integrate ensemble forecast where we use the ocean atmosphere coupled system. And this is a Taylor forecast product at the end. So this is an example from the ECMWF seasonal forecast system, system 4. We have anomalies of the SSTs. You can have tropical cyclone predictions, or you have ENSO, an El Niño prediction. Okay. So which information do we use to initialize the atmosphere? So we use quite a lot of different types of instruments. We use satellites, use stationary satellites. We use polar orbiting satellites for ozone, GPS satellites. We use also aircraft. You have also drop zones, you have also radars, and you have also synop data from land and also from ship. You have also buoys, drifting mode. So you have quite a large number of instruments now. And there's been a really very strong increase, I will show that later, in the number of observations coming from satellites. Actually, that's been quite a big revolution over the recent years. So to give you an order of magnitude, we receive about 150 million observations, 99% from satellites are received daily. The current system, data submission system, ECMWF, uses only 15 million observations, so 10%, 96% from satellites, which are used every 12 hours. So the coverage of satellites is usually very good. I mean, you cover the most of the areas. For land observations, it's a bit which are crucial for really high quality initial conditions. Yes?
Just to point out that we're emphasizing on the satellite usage, and that's an order of magnitude higher than like the interior instrument system.
Yes, exactly, 10 years ago. I will show a slide later on showing this. Yes, Serra Interim is about 1.5 million. Yes. So the land observations over land are very inhomogeneous. You get areas which are extremely well covered, very well covered, and some area where you have very few observations. So there is much more observation over land than over ocean. So over land, there's still a very strong inhomogeneity. And and from the ocean initialization, for the ocean observations, we initialize the ocean by running an ocean model. For that, we need observation of SST, atmospheric fluxes from atmospheric reanalysis, and we need subsurface ocean information. So the observation from the ocean have, for the ocean have also witnessed quite a very strong, big revolution over the recent years. So before 1982, the only ocean observation we had were HBTs, which were measurements from ships. So those were scientific vessels, or could be ships of opportunity, so like commercial ships, which were doing some measurements. So you can see here, for example, the tracks of those measurements. And it was mostly at the, near the surface of the ocean. You didn't measure the deep ocean. From 1982, it was the introduction of a satellite observation for the ocean. But the electromagnetic radiation from the satellite don't penetrate inside the ocean. So the information you get from satellites for the ocean are only for SST under the sea level. And from 1983, okay, during the 1980s, there were two very strong El Nino events. There was the 1982, 82, 83, 86, 87, which generated a lot of interest for El Nino. And the scientific community realized that there was very little observations to really be able to produce very good forecasts of those El Nino. So there has been a project called Togacor in 90, which led to the installation of moorings, the Tao and the Triton moorings, in the Pacific, in the equatorial Pacific, and which was extended to the Pirata in the Atlantic, and later on to Mara in the Indian Ocean. So this is all an array of buoys which are anchored to the bottom of the ocean, and they are extremely useful, and they started in 1993, so to produce a time series of temperature, salinity, currents, for example, from 1983 to now. The problem of those buoys, as an example here, is that they are very, very costly to maintain. There's been a vessel, actually, a scientific vessel from US, which is really used full time to maintain the buoys in the tropical Pacific. There's a lot of problem of some of them shutting down for technical reasons. There's a lot of vandalism. Some are stolen because they contain some quite expensive piece of equipment. And recently, actually, this vessel was refurbished, and only 20 or 30% of those buoys are still active. So there has been some talk recently to suppress them or to replace them to something else. So there is still no conclusion about that. Because since 2001, and that has been the really big revolution for the ocean observation, is the use of Argo floats, which became really operational, fully operational in 2005. So those floats start at the surface. They are not anchored to the bottom of the ocean. They are just floating. They go down to about 2,000 meters, give measurements of temperature, salinity. Those give very good profile of the ocean subsurface. And then they go up, transmit the information to the satellite. We give it to the operational centers, and then go down again and again. So they are not always located at the same location. They can drift. But there is so many of those buoys that actually it covers very well the whole ocean, all the oceans, so as we can see here. So this plot here shows the coverage, an example for June 1982. So the only observation, as I said at that time, were HBTs, so from ships, so you can see the ship tracks. So you can see that area where you have a lot of commercial ships are somewhat covered. You have some bizarre trajectory like this one, which is actually a scientific vessel, probably, which was observing the East Pacific. And this is coverage now, but you can see that entire area, for example, here, of the South Pacific and the Antarctic regions are completely devoid of any observations. The South Indian Ocean was very poorly observed also. This is an observation from November 2005. There's even more now. So we can see still the ships being used, HBT observation in black. The red is the Tau Triton array, Pirata in the Atlantic, Mara here, a few moorings in the Indian Ocean. So they are all along, they are a network all along the tropical ocean. And all the blue represent one of those Argo floats. So we have quite a nice coverage about it. So as you can see, the problem for reanalysis is that we have a very strong inconsistency in the observing system from one period to another. And for the ocean reanalysis, it can be quite a problem. It means that we have, a correct observation of the ocean only since November 2005. Okay, and this is from the atmosphere too. We have the same problem of inconsistency in time. This is a number of satellite observations used at CCMWF. Similar plots that Adrian showed the other day, a bit more recent. And we can see there's been a revolution in the really, really huge increase in the number of satellites used. So for ERA interim, we were at that time. So we have much, much more observations now. And once again, for reanalysis, this is quite a challenging because it means that there will be some inconsistency before 2000 and after more recent periods. Okay. So once you get the observation, you have to go to the next step, which is a data simulation. The idea here is to use those observations to produce the best estimate as possible of the initial conditions and to project them into the model world. The way it is done usually, like ICMWF, is to use a 4D var data estimation where you run from the previous analysis a forecast, simple forecast, which is called the first guess, and you compare it with new observations at the time, the recent time, and then you change the trajectory. Okay, so as once again, every 12 or 50 million observations are asymmetric to correct 100 million variables that define the model's virtual atmosphere. And the assimilation relies strongly on the quality of the model. So the quality of initial condition is due to the quality of the observations themselves, but also the quality of the model, which is the same which is used to produce the forecast. One thing I want to point out is this data simulation is extremely costly. I mean, at CCMWF, the data simulation is done with a 4D var at 16 kilometers, which is the same resolution as the high resolution model, and it's about 5 times more costly to run the data simulation than to run a forecast. So this is really the big part, which is of the cost of forecasting a system. So this is an example from 4D var. So we start from analysis, we run what we call a backward forecast, the first guess, and then we modify slightly the initial condition, the initial condition so that the trajectory fits the best with the observations. And then we start the forecast. Okay, so the assimilation is very important for the, particularly for the ocean, because models have their own drift, they have their own climate. And if you don't use any observations, then you can get a relatively wrong mislayered depth. And this estimation is particularly important to correct the slope and the mean depth of the equatorial thermocline. So in a free model, for instance, we get an equatorial thermocline like this. After a data simulation, we tend to get usually a much more realistic data simulation. So it's a very important process for the forecast. So once you have done this, you start your forecast. And one issue you have with the forecast is, as was discussed 2 days ago, is the initialization shock, which is an accelerated development of model errors at the beginning of the forecast, which can be due to several things. One, there is an inconsistency between the model atmospheric initial conditions and the model physics. That's why people try to use the same model for data simulation and model integrations, which can reduce this problem. But when you do a reforecast, you start usually from a reanalysis which has been produced from sometime a different operational centers. For example, you use ERA interim. That's the case, for example, at the Bureau of Meteorology, where they are using ERA interim, and they start with the atmospheric model is completely different. And this created a shock. Problem two is that usually atmosphere and ocean are initialized separately. You have a data simulation for DVAR for atmosphere, at ICMWF, for example, 3 DVAR for the ocean. And they may not be in close balance at the start of the model integration. We also perturb differently the atmosphere with the ocean, so there is a bit of inconsistency between the two. So there are several solutions. Some people do the nudging techniques, which consists to run the model over the past weeks, months, with the dynamical parameters relaxed towards analysis or reanalysis. This will ensure that the initial condition to be more consistent with model physics. There's been an example from Bureau of Meteorology. As I say, their reforecast started with from ERA interim, and they had a big shock at the beginning. So what they did is to run their own model and relax the UVT to ERA interim, and then start the initial condition from that. And this gave much, much better results, actually. And the other trend is to go to topo data simulation, which can reduce the initialization shock, since the atmosphere and the ocean will be closer balanced at the start of the integration. So regarding full coupled data, about coupled data simulation, the advantages is you have a more balanced ocean atmosphere and perturbations, so important for tropical convection. This is also a framework to treat model error, initialization and forecast, and consistency across time scales. So current approach is to go for weak coupled data simulation, which means that you run the first guess with a coupled model, but you produce a separate data simulation for ocean atmosphere. That's the example is done at NSEP with CFSA, ECMWF with the ESA Sierra project. So our next analysis, for instance, ERA 5, will be produced with a coupled weak coupled data simulation. strong coupled data simulation is much more difficult because the atmosphere and ocean have very different time scales. And the data simulation uses a much longer windows in the ocean than in the atmosphere. So usually, the technique use usually is Ansible command filter. Okay? So now we have initial conditions. We can run your model. And as I mentioned previously, for sub-seasonal forecast, we need to run reforecast. We run a real-time forecast, for example, SMWF with 51-member ensemble, and then we calibrate with a 5-member ensemble at that time from 1984 to 2013. Now, what is very important is to... So this reforecast or handcast is used to estimate the climate of the model. And what is quite important is the initialization of this reforecast to be as consistent as possible with the initialization of the real-time forecast. So for example, at SMWF, the initial conditions from the reforecast are used in ERA interim because we don't have the same analysis as for the real-time forecast. We use a ocean reanalysis, soil analysis, and perturbation. We use try to mimic exactly the same type of perturbation we do for the real-time forecast using C-Lola vectors. And ensemble data simulation for recent years because we don't have them in the past, and then backscatter schemes, and then stochastic physics. Now, this is, I would say, quite a very difficult, very big challenge for sub-seasonal and seasonal predictions is to get this right. I mean, so here I will show you an example of a forecast which was issued quite some time ago. I mean, this it was an issue on the 11th of May 2006. It shows a probability of 2 meter temperature to be in the lowest decile. So red means you have warm conditions, blue, cold conditions. So can someone spot something weird about this forecast? Sorry? The point here, exactly, yeah. So this looks a bit weird to have in middle of sort of, this was a period of heat wave, just a few points, which tells you that actually the temperature will be much colder than normal. So we actually, when we issued this forecast, we got a phone call from Meteo Suisse wondering what was going on. They say, what tell you exactly what they say? So what can cause this? I mean, what do you think was the reason for this problem? Does anybody have any idea what can cause that? Adrian? Partially. I mean, that's our origin is too of high orography. And for those of you who are not very familiar from with the Europe geography, this is Switzerland, so you have the Alps, and so very high topography. And the operation analysis is a much higher resolution than the ERA interim. At that time, actually, we were using ERA 40, which was at T159. So that was part of the problem, but it was not all of it. The main reason when we look at it was actually to look at the surface initial conditions. And in May, here we are in May, and we look at the snow analysis. So this plot here shows you the volume of snow from the SMWF analysis from 1994 to 2006 over a globe here. So what it shows is that from 1994 to 2003, there is virtually no snow in the SMWF analysis over Switzerland. And suddenly, after 2004 to 2006, the analysis tells you there should be quite about 10 centimeters of snow on average over this area. And if we look at observations over Switzerland, we can see that there should always be snow, and there is nothing special from 2004 onward. Now, what happened is that in 2004, we started to use an SD satellite, which gave a much better observation of snow. The data simulation scheme changed, although the snow scheme in the land parameterization changed, which means that this increase is, of course, completely artificial. So in ERA interim, and it's also true in ERA interim, there is virtually no snow in Switzerland at this time of the year, whereas in the operation analysis, you have quite a lot of snow. So what happens here is that the real-time forecast starts with snow, so very cold conditions, and you calibrate with a reef forecast which have no snow. So that's why you get a sort of permanent cold spot over Switzerland. And this cold spot can last 30 days because the snow takes a long time to melt. And you could see all along the spring period and over all the monthly forecasts from 2005, 2006. So that was really a big problem of inconsistency between real time and reforecast. And this is a reason since that we do not use the soil initial condition for Mira Interim because it's a completely obsolete scheme. It's also true for snow. It's also true for soil moisture. It uses a Tessol scheme, not a H-Tessol. We can do a sort of recalibration, but it's not as good. It still causes problems. That's why we are using a soil reanalysis, which consists in running the H-Tessol model, which is our soil analysis model, forced by ERA interim, and also corrected by GPCP because the precipitation from ERA interim are not that good. And simply so do 20, 30 years reanalysis. And it's very, very cheap because it's not really a data simulation. We don't assimilate observations. And it takes about 2 days to run 20 years of reforecast. And the advantage of it, too, is that we can run it at the same resolution as the real-time forecast, as the first 10 days of forecast at 32 kilometers. So we don't need after that to interpolate to get the right model resolution, which can sometimes be a cause of problems. So to give you an idea, this is an example of the snow. This is a total snow cover in January. So I think that January 79. This was from in ERA interim, and that with a new scheme, with a new model. And this model is now perfectly consistent with the one we use in a real-time forecast. So we ensure at least much more consistency. And you can see quite some difference. First of all, in ERA interim, it's a much, much more smoother field. This one has much better, handled much better the topography. And you can see some very big difference over Canada. Here we have much more snow in ERA interim than you get in this new soil reanalysis. So if you do the difference between the new climate, new summer snow cover from the new soil analysis minus ERA interim, that's the surface temperature, you can find differences of the order of more than 4 to 8 degrees in the high latitudes. Not so much, of course, in the tropics. And this can generate very different forecasts. So here is an example of a forecast from 1st of January 2011. We are looking at day 5 to 11. And this is the real-time forecast is the same, but in this left panel, we calibrate, we produce an anomaly relative to a reforecast initialized from ERA interim. So it tells you there will be cold anomaly over the west coast of Canada, warm anomaly here. On the right is a forecast, so with the same real-time forecast once again, but this time calibrated from a new reforecast initialized from this new soil initial conditions. And you can get the almost exact opposite signal. Here it tells you it's warm and it will be cold over the near the lakes. And if we compare with synop data, we find this one is much more consistent with synop data anomalies than with old one. So once again, this is something that is very important for substitutional signal forecast, is this consistency between real time and reforecast. And that's a problem for people who are using, for example, ERA interim to initialize their reforecast on their own analysis for real-time forecast. You can generate very, very unrealistic signal. Okay, ensemble generation. It was a bit covered over the last days, but here we do a bit of a repeat. So as I say, there is a lot of different for S2S model, different strategies to initialize to generate the ensemble members. So first of all, why do we need ensembles? Because the models are not perfect. The model can fail for several reasons. The initial conditions are not accurate enough. They are due to poor coverage and observation error in the assimilation. That's the initial uncertainty. So for example, here we have a poor coverage of Atlantic, which can generate model errors. And the model used to assimilate the data and to make a forecast are not perfect. They describe only an approximate way of the true atmospheric phenomena. So the addition of them means that our forecast may go to the wrong direction. So we need to sample those errors. on the Ansible prediction, the goal so is to estimate the probability density function of forecast, taking into account all possible source of forecast error. So we start from a PDF of the initial conditions to measure the uncertainty in the initial conditions. Then we propagate our forecast and to obtain a PDF at the end. So this is quite an important process because it gives a very important information to the user of how confident it can be. As an example here is predictability for tropical cyclones. So here we have tropical cyclone, so the black line represents the hydration and deterministic forecast. And the colors represent the probability distribution. So it shows here that most of the old Ansible members basically predict that the storm will recurve and go in this direction. So the spread here is relatively small, showing that people can really trust, for forecasters can really have more trust in this forecast. You have other cases where you can see the Ansible going in all directions, which can tell the forecaster that, well, for this case, we may not know what is going to happen. And that's an information you cannot get with a single deterministic forecast. So that's something really important for the users. So, okay, they tell you for each Ansible member, so you have 51 of them, what is the intensity of the tropical cyclone for day 1 up to day 10? So if it's orange, it tells you it's a tropical storm, so green is a depression, and orange means it's a hurricane. So it gives you a bit more idea of the distribution. And some Ansible members go here more than 7 days, some stop at day 7. So it's a way to see what is going to happen. So how to create initial perturbation? A simple method is a lag approach. That's why we did a CMWF for a seasonal forecast system 1. It simply will run the model one Ansible member every day. And the difference from day to day is a measure for uncertainty, basically. And to create an Ansible forecast for seasonal forecast, we were taking simply all the seasonal forecasts starting from the 15th of a month to the 15th of the following month, which give you a 30-member Ansible. And that was a way to create the model. Some model in S2S, like Met Office, also are running their model once a day, but with 4 Ansible members. So it's a bit still the same ID. And the other technique is to do burst initial conditions, like at SMWF. Here we run 51 Ansible members from 15 perturbed initial conditions versus the lag Ansible, where you can run several Ansible members once a day. So, as discussed already, I mean, I won't go too much into this. There is advantage to each. One thing I want to say is that the burst approach, the advantage, it uses the freshest initial conditions. And you have more control on the Ansible generation. The other one is a bit ad hoc. You initialize the model from one day apart, and you expect that it will give you the right Ansible spread. Whereas with the burst approach, you can really calibrate well your Ansible spread so that the IMS error match the spread. The disadvantage of a burst approach is that, first of all, it's too costly to run daily, at least for subseasonal forecasts. For medium range, we run it twice a day. But for subseasonal forecasts, we run it currently twice a week. And something that really forecasters absolutely hate is what I call the flip-flop forecast. So you have a forecast in one day which tells you, well, next Sunday it will be very rainy over 3 years. Be very careful. There will be very difficult conditions. And the following forecast, which is issued 12 hours later, tells you actually it will be very sunny. And the forecast 12 hours later come back to very wet conditions. And the one after came back again to sunny conditions. And that's something which happens sometimes, which is called we flip-flop. And once again, sometimes the forecaster prefers the model to be totally wrong, consistently wrong, than to have this sort of jumps. Yes? No, we haven't done that. And that's something we plan to do in S2S, actually. And S2S database will be quite useful for that. I mean, that's one big question, actually, for the S2S database to understand what is the best approach. As I say, we don't know yet what is the benefit, or they really compare. Yes?
Why the first approach
Because a large approach, you average over 7 days, okay? So you sample much more forecasts. Usually, more forecasts are evolving much slowly from day to day. Okay, so if your forecast suddenly becomes different, you still have six forecasts we are the same before, and then you see the variation is really fluctuating much more slowly. And that's what people prefer sometimes. You have a much smoother evolution of forecasts. Also, the forecast can be less skillful for one given time than the burst approach. On the longer, actually, you take the, your windows to average, so the smoother, actually, you are, and the less dramatic change you have. Yeah. Yes, but the problem, if you do that, then your sample becomes to be very small. You get to, so that's a trade-off. And that's, again, an important new question we plan to address. For example, NSEP has a 16-member ensemble every day. So what is the best strategy? Is just to issue like a 16-member burst ensemble and do all your forecast probability on those 16-member? Or is it more skillful to combine with the day before to get a 32-member ensemble and degrade slightly your initial condition? Or to go 3 days behind, then you have a bigger ensemble, can do maybe a more accurate prediction of extreme events and so on. So that's an important question we need to address. So, but on the response to this may depend on the time range, because for short range forecast, there's really a huge disadvantage to use a lag approach, because the quality of the initial condition will be dramatic, will have a dramatic effect. For longer, for single time range, may probably not matter, because we are long enough to lose this memory. Okay, so there's for the burst sample, there's two different approaches. There's a Monte Carlo approach, which is to sample all sorts of forecast error and to perturb it on any model parameter that is not perfectly known. So it's taking into consideration as many sources of as possible of forecast error and then perturb them randomly. Or there's a reduced sampling, which is mostly used in operational centers, is to try to target specific source of forecast errors and prioritize. So optimize the sampling. And for that, that's what is used at NSEP, PCMWF, is to try to detect the growing components which will dominate the forecast error growth. Because we have a big constraint also is limited resources. So how should initial conditions be defined? We have to find in which directions the error growth as we have a maximum growth. So you have two different techniques. I won't go into details. Don't worry, I'm going to the equations. But one is a singular vectors technique at SMWF. The goal is to find, we built a linear version of our model, and we look at which directions have the largest growth after 48 hours. And then that was the way we define our 50-member ensemble. NSEP has a different technique, which is a breeding vector. Here they are based on perturbation of growing fastest in the analysis cycles, and then adding a random perturbation, evolving and rescaling, and then repeat. But since they're quite evolving quickly. And then we have also a new technique starting, is the ensemble data simulation. So here the philosophy is a bit the same as for the forecast. Initially, the medium range forecasts were issued with only one single model, high resolution model. And in the 1990s, we went to the ensemble models, trying to quantify the uncertainty after the forecast. And for the data simulation, it's the same. For a very long time, we had just one single data simulation at very high resolution, 16 kilometers. And now, as with the forecast, we have an ensemble of data simulation for using 4DVAR, but a much lower resolution, which are used to perturb the main analysis. So we don't start actually exactly from the each ensemble data simulation member. What we do is to compute the difference between the two ensemble members of data simulation and add it to the high resolution analysis, because we find that the high resolution analysis really give you an advantage in the short medium range forecast. So the way it works, so that we now have an ensemble of data simulation, and that's where we start to run our model. If those ensemble data simulation were perfect, we should just, that should be enough to perturb your ensemble. The problem is that the spread with the ensemble data simulation alone is not large enough. So we still need to combine those ensemble data simulation with the breeding vectors or singular vectors to generate our ensemble. Okay. For the ocean, the ocean lags a bit behind the atmosphere in terms of technique for ensemble generation. What we are doing at SMWF is a very ad hoc way to perturb the ocean. We do an ocean ensemble of data simulation. We produce five ocean analysis or reanalysis by perturbing randomly surface winds used to force the ocean model. And in addition to that, we add a random SST perturbation as added at time step zero. So those random perturbations are calculated by taking the difference between different SST products that give us a sort of idea of what is the uncertainty in the SSTs. And we apply them randomly, those step zero, and we give them a 3D structure up today to 60 meters. And the plan is to use weekly coupled data simulation in the future to initialize both atmosphere ocean. Yes? Yeah.
So what's the difference between the yellow and the green color?
Oh, this one is the first guess. So before we do the data simulation, and then after you compare with observation, you modify slightly the trajectory so that they fit the observations. So that's really where your initial condition will be, and then you start your first EPS. So this one, is the red one, is the first guess, the first run. You start your analysis, you run your model for 6 hours, something like that. And then you do corrections, and that's the second, which gives you the other tracks. And then you start.
Exactly after 12 hours?
Sorry?
Exactly after the 12 hours, you change the...
Yes. 12-hour window. Yes, that's a 12-hour window. Yes, sorry. Yeah, not 6 hours. Yes. And then you start at 21, then the forecast. Okay. So you have seen that. What is important is the reliability of the ensemble. Normally, in a reliable ensemble, ensemble spread is a predictor of ensemble error. So you expect your error to be generally inside the ensemble distribution, as was explained in previous talks. Problem, if your model is under-dispersive, it means that the error is often outside your error, so your model is overconfident. So we have seen this previously. So the problem is that if you just perturb your ensemble, you just perturb your initial condition the way I explained, you usually end up with quite an under-dispersive spread. The spread is generally too small because you have not taken into account another important source of errors, which is the model errors. So the physics, as you can, the processes we try to simulate in our model are very complex. We use, as Adrian explained, parametrizations, which are not perfect. And we need so to estimate to add this uncertainty in the model physics into our model integrations. So particularly the atmosphere exhibits and upstream propagation of kinetic energy at all time scale. So the grid are relatively large, so there's a lot of processes which are not resolved by your grid because your mesh of your model is way too large. Even 60 kilometers is too large to really represent correctly the upscale propagation of kinetic energy, for instance. So to represent model errors, there are several techniques. One is to use a different physics parametrization for each ensemble member. It's not something we like to do here for subsignal signal forecast because it means that each ensemble member will have a completely different physics of different climatology. One other way is to do multimodal ensemble, but it's a bit the same problem as this one. You have different models with completely different physics. Or you have to also perturb explicitly the model with the stochastic schemes. For example, ICMWF, we use two schemes. I will go briefly into that. I don't want to go into details. We have a SPPT scheme and a backscatter scheme. So the SPPT scheme was initially implemented in 1998, was revised in 2009. The idea here is to simulate model uncertainty due to physical parameterization. And it's done in two steps by taking the net parameterized physics tendency of UVTQ from coming from radiation, gravity wave drag, vertical mixing, convection, cloud physics, and added a noise to it. And we had a coefficient also to go to zero near the surface and the stratosphere. So originally, there was only one pattern of random perturbations. In the more recent physics, we had different patterns to target different time scales. This is a time scale of 6 hours, 3 days, And then for 30 days, we have a scale of more of the order of 2,000 kilometers. Okay, and this is, for example, here's the evolution of this this random parameter. We can see for the 6 hourly, which can go from minus 1 to 1. And then we have the one at 3 day time scale, which is a much lower, much slower evolution, and the one for 30 days, which is more important for seasonal forecasting. Okay? Yeah? Is in, sorry, in time? Yes. It's evolving with time, yes. Yes. It's computed at each time step, yes. Yes, it's evolved during the model integration. And the second one is a bad scatter scheme. I don't want to go into details. Just to say it, the main goal is to attempt to simulate a process that was absent from the model, which is the upscale transfer of energy from subgrid scales. If you are interested, you can find some literature about it. I mean, it would take quite a while to go deep into this. But the point I want to make is stochastic physics schemes, they have a strong impact on the spread of the ensemble. They allow the model to be more reliable, more. But they also have some impact on the model climate, actually. And one impact, for example, is on the MGO, where we find it. Where in general, the green line represents the number of days an MGO in system 4, seasonal forecast system 4, is in phase 1 to phase 8. So you can see on black is the verification for Mira interim. So you can see that in general, in system 4, the model has a much weaker MGO, much less day in the active phase of the MGO. So here we are looking only at the cases where the amplitude of the MGO is larger than 1. On the red is when we use the stochastic, so green is without stochastic physics, and the red is with stochastic physics. So we see quite a slight improvement. It's not far, it's still far from observation, from the reanalysis, but there is quite some improvement. For that, it's because the impact is not completely linear. So you don't, and you get a better representation slightly of a convection. And once again, with this upscale, you get a much better representation of energy, cascade of energy from small scale. You have better interaction from small to large scale, the cascade of energy from one to another. Sorry?
What is the result?
It's a green, yes, a green one, yes. Without stochastic physics, yes. Black one is a verification.
So it's a control focus. Without this stochastic TV, with only 51 number ensemble without stochastic.
Sorry, if you combine them, you mean? So the green one is a run, a seasonal forecast without any stochastic visit, without SPPT and bad scatter scheme. So you just perturb the initial conditions. And the red is if you add this stochastic physics in this. And the black one is a verification. So you see a slight improvement when you have stochastic physics.
Both schemes,
yeah. Yeah, with both schemes. We did also test with each scheme separately. And in this case, it was the SPPT scheme, which was actually more important. And here's another way to see this, is a distribution of. So that's once again impact of both schemes together to see the distribution of number of days with an MGO as a function of the amplitude of the MGO. And that's from ERA interim, so that's the verifications, then from with stochastic physics off, so just to perturb initial condition with the system 4 with stochastic physics. So it's difficult to see here by highs the difference. You have a feeling that there's more days with a higher MGO amplitude in this case and this one. And this plot shows the difference between this one and this one with stochastic physics and without stochastic physics, showing that when you have stochastic physics off, you tend to get more days with a weak MGO, without MGO, and less day with strong MGO. So this goes to the same direction as with ERA interim. So this one is more realistic, closer to ERA interim than this one. So once again, it makes the point that with stochastic visit, you tend to generate also stronger MGO events. Okay, so in reliable ensemble, as was mentioned, we expect the reliability, the ensemble spread, and to be to cover the MS error. Another way to see it is if your model is really well calibrated, then you should get a more reliable forecast. So you expect that when the model predicts a 0% chance to happen, an event, it should happen 0%, you should be zoned along the diagonal. And this is generally what we get in the medium range forecast. The problem is that for models like SMWF, where the subsidional forecasts are an extension of the medium range forecast, most of those techniques to perturb the ensemble are usually have been designed on targeting really the short medium range. For example, the singular vectors are targeting a maximum growth at 48 hours, which is not necessarily what is important for MGO prediction or for long range prediction. So if we look, for example, at the MGO, this is a skill score. This represents the IMS error from the SMWF model, which go from day zero here to day 45. Green is climatology, so we reach climatology around day 25, around day 30. But the blue line represents the spread, the ensemble spread, which shows that the ensemble spread is much smaller than the IMS error, which means that the model is overconfident. Normally, those two curves, if the model was perfectly calibrated, then the ensemble spread should be on top of the IMS error, so, which means there is still some work to be done to really we may need to really target specifically some events like MGO in our perturbations. There has been some work done at NASA, for example, to define singular vectors targeting specifically the MGO. But things have gone a bit better recently with ensemble data simulation, because before the singular vectors were applied only in the extra tropics. Tropics were before not perturbed in the initial conditions, whereas no ensemble data simulation allowed to perturb the whole globe. So conclusions. So we have now a very large number of observations are used to initialize atmosphere and ocean. The initial shock is an important issue when starting a forecast. The copper data simulation and nudging techniques may help to reduce initial shocks. Reforecast and real-time initial conditions. Reforecast and real-time initial conditions need to be as consistent as possible. And that's, I would say, a big challenge for operational centers. There are various strategies for ensemble generation, bird versus large ensemble, not clear which one is optimal. And ensemble generation includes perturbation in the initial conditions, perturbation in the model physics. It's optimized for medium-range forecasts usually, but not necessarily for extended-range and seasonal forecasts.